From June 5 to September 14, 2014, the San Jose Museum of Art is hosting Legacy, the Emily Fisher Landau Collection. This summer, the museum will kick off its year-long 45th anniversary celebration with a landmark exhibition of post-war American art by such prominent artists as Jasper Johns, Willem de Kooning, Barbara Kruger, Jenny Holzer, Ad Rauscha, and Andy Warhol. Legacy gives Bay Area audiences access to extraordinary works by a pantheon of innovative and pivotal artists, said Susan Crane, Oshman Executive Director. These stellar American artists are now part of the American canon of contemporary art history. Yet, when Emily Fisher Landau collected their art, they were radically adventurous and far from famous. The collection she shaped with such gumption is an exciting overview of one of the most important and expansive periods in American art, when no few styles or movements held sway. Legacy comprises some 70 works by 38 artists who pushed the boundaries of painterly abstraction, realism, and social commentary. The broad variety of media represented includes painting, ink on paper, collage, screen printing, and sculpture. The exhibition encompasses many post-war art movements, abstract expressionism, pop art, minimalism, conceptualism, feminist art, and postmodernism.
So this is a Rosenquist. It speaks to consumerism in the same, kind of the opposite way of an Andy Warhol. Instead of celebrating consumerism, he talks about the downside of it. We see a woman with a gloved hand trying to hold together the world by keeping a grocery bag that is too filled from falling apart. And the lipsticks represent missiles. And here, Andy Warhol is showing us some celebrities, some kind of cultural icons. There's Howdy Doody, there's Uncle Sam, Aunt Jemima, the Wicked Witch of the West, and Andy Warhol as an icon himself. This is by Ed Ruscha, and I think the title of this piece says everything about the collector and about this exhibition. The act of letting a person into your home says a lot. When you have a piece of artwork and you bring it into your home, you're living with the manifestation of the soul of the artist. Emily Fisher Landau, this was her favorite piece. She gave it to the Whitney because she believes in supporting a museum with the best work that she can. So this is one of four of the Ed Ruscha's in this exhibition. And it's the most unusual of the four because it is not just about pop or conceptualism. And you can see it has no lettering at all, no text. But it's Ed Ruscha dipping into surrealism. This is by Mark Tansey. And Mark Tansey grew up here in San Jose. His parents were professors at San Jose State. And this is a really beautiful, very intricately done landscape. In the foreground, at the bottom, you see text and you see soldiers. It's a beautiful landscape.
Thank you.
is David Varnavrich, and he is one of four artists in this exhibition who died of AIDS. And this piece speaks to that, but it also speaks to the love of gold, and that a lot of people in this country have. It's called Das Rheingold, which is a play on the opera, but also the Rhine gold. So it's you see money, and you see different collaged elements of consumerism as well as some cells that indicate the AIDS virus. We're looking at a piece by Glenn Ligon that was made in response to a brutal rape of a young woman in Central Park. There were five teenagers who were Black or Latino who were falsely accused of raping the woman, and this is the text of the front pages of the New York Times. The young men were falsely imprisoned for over a decade before they were released. And over here, we have a tree by Rodney Graham. And this is kind of an interesting piece to be in this gallery. It is, although it looks as if it were done in the by using a camera obscura, it was not. But he pays homage to the camera obscura. After he printed out this piece, he turned the tree upside down to frame it. And it's we like to see it in here because this whole gallery is filled with kind of upside down thinking. The artwork was came out of some upside down thinking that society has, like about AIDS or about race. This is one of Keith Haring's iconic pieces. We see X's on the foreheads of the two men to show that somehow they are marginalized. They happen to be marginalized because they have contracted the AIDS virus. This piece isn't meant to be seen as erotic. It's meant to be seen as a warning, not a moral warning, but a physical health warning to use safe sex. And here we have a piece by David Varnavrich, and it is two men kissing with the background of a world map that you can see in any classroom across the United States. And here we have an image of the cells of an AIDS virus. Thank you. I'm Susan Leask of the San Jose Museum of Art, and I'm standing in front of a Martin Perrier sculpture. This is represents the perfect Euclidean circle with a little touch of wabi-sabi. So it's not perfect, but it's done by an artist who needs desperately to be making things with his hands. And this is Susan Rothenberg. This is called Tuning Fork. And we know her work as, she does a lot of figurative work and a lot of work with horses. And when you first look at this, you realize it's about three things. It's about music, the tuning fork, and you see the frontal view, a frontal view of a horse, and you see the figure in it as well. And this is de Kooning. And one thing I really like about this piece of art is that the gestures replicate the same type of line work that he used in his famous women's series. Thank you.